The Silk Road of Asia leads far into the West. Along this ancient path, the winds of turbulent change are stirring once again. The Silk Road stretches all the way from Xi'an, China, through the Middle East to Rome, Italy. This episode will focus on the Kyrgyz Republic and the Republic of Uzbekistan, created after the fall of the Soviet Union. This once barren land is now a burgeoning new town. With the creation of new countries, the flow of people and goods has surged. Brought from across the border, the Chinese products imported into the area have transformed the cotton fields into an enormous bazaar. The various ethnic groups that have long lived side by side in this old capital oasis city are about to change the course of its history. Nearly two decades after the fall of the Soviet Union, we visit the people living along the Oasis Road. This is the Kyrgyz Republic in Central Asia. First, we travel a road 3,200 meters above sea level and head to the Chinese border. During the Soviet era, the border with China was closed for nearly 50 years due to political tensions. We've learned that the border has now reopened and the Silk Road is once again revived. This is the border gate between Kyrgyzstan and China. On the other side of the gate is a neutral zone, where trucks loaded with cargo from China line up, waiting to enter. After independence, Kyrgyzstan aggressively pushed forward with an open market economy and has been reaping the benefits of free trade with China. On the other hand, China, one of the world's largest producers of goods, has been seeking a new market in Central Asia. Indeed, this is an enormous mound of Chinese products. The contents are garments, shoes, soap, and all the daily necessities. The border guard shows us something of interest. A wolf pup was found during patrol. Since long ago, this Silk Road that runs between oases has been known to be a dangerous path with wandering packs of wolves. What was previously just a wasteland of state border has now developed into a new city called Irkistan. Since the day this city was built, 43-year-old Erkenbeck has been living here. At 8 a.m., he leaves for work from the town where a row of Soviet-era railroad cars, now being used as shelter, line up. Erkenbeck is a laborer who loads and unloads cargo, products brought in from China. During the Soviet era, Erkenbeck earned a steady income working at a collective farm where he was raising sheep. However, when he was 27, the Soviet Union collapsed. The collective farm became privatized, and his salary was cut in half. Furthermore, after the country's independence, the sudden shift towards a free market caused an unprecedented economic crisis. At that time, it is said that the unemployment rate reached 50%. Erkenbeck worked on various projects like road construction and hopped from job to job until he arrived at this town. Today, approximately 500 people live in this town. There is even electricity and phone service. Those selling groceries to the workers have begun gathering in this place. This railroad car serves as both a home and a storefront. During the harsh, cold winters, the temperature can drop to minus 30 degrees Celsius. Even now, the economy of Kyrgyzstan has not fully recovered to the level of the Soviet era. Therefore, young people seeking jobs come here from all over the country. It has been over 10 years since the creation of Erkenbeck. The many children who are born here call it their hometown. At 6:30 in the evening, Erkenbeck has finally finished a day's work. His daily pay is about $8. To feed his wife and three children back in his hometown, he has been working away from his home for 10 years. Erkenbeck shares the railroad car with three of his co-workers. It's time for supper. The landlord and her daughter come to prepare a meal. The rent, including meals, is $65 per month.
Ремонт verdiği semyen çok olsa cakşıdı. Aval yem tala ceri. Bir de cat bir şey değilsin hatta vibilon kandaytan. O her kılınası olutta durmuştu.
Erkenbeck has plans to take time off in a month to visit his family. He hasn't seen them for a long time. At 9 a.m., the sound of truck engines reverberates throughout the town. Trucks carrying Chinese products heading further west prepare for departure. We were given permission to ride on this Soviet manufactured truck loaded with a massive cargo of garments. This vehicle is a quarter century old. This is 24-year-old Altenbeck. Just 1 month ago, he inherited his brother's truck and became a driver. Following the Silk Road from Oasis to Oasis, from Irkeshtam to our destination of Osh, will take 18 hours. At the time of Kyrgyzstan's independence, Altenbeck was just 8 years old and dreamt of becoming an engineer. In order to sustain the economy, Kyrgyzstan encourages people to train to be technicians for new industries. Altenbeck pursued his dream of being an engineer and attended college to study electrical engineering. Kyrgyzstan is struggling to develop new industry. As a result, Altenbeck was unable to find employment that would use his education. Altenbeck supports his parents and younger brother. His older brother, a former truck driver, was killed a month ago in an accident. At the border of China, he was crushed between the truck and luggage while loading cargo. On the way to the hospital, at the foot of the mountain, he took his last breath on this very road. A truck has stopped in the road. It looks like it has a flat tire. Altenbeck has decided to lend them his spare tire.
Okay. Bold, almak.
On this road, drivers frequently experience flat tires. Battling with a bad road, the truck drivers made an implicit agreement to help each other in times of trouble. Since its independence, Kyrgyzstan has been unable to provide infrastructure maintenance, such as road repair, due to lack of funds. The rough road is a burden to these drivers. At an elevation of 3,615 meters, we encounter the route's most dangerous juncture. The road continues to wind, and in this section descends 1,000 meters in one stretch. Seventeen tons of heavy cargo bears down on the steering wheel. After descending the mountain safely, Altınbek gets melted snow water for drinking. It has been 18 hours since our departure. We arrive at Osh, Kyrgyzstan's second largest city. His mother, Belulu, has been waiting for him.
Biz korkoz joldordon kelgende. Joldorunu gördüngör. Kınçılıktarın oşon jün kutup alabız. Kelişin.
Because wages are three times that of the laborers who unload cargo, the truck drivers face fierce competition among each other. They must deliver the cargo quickly and safely. Otherwise, they risk losing the next job. Altınbek will rest for one day and then once again return to the border of China. The Chinese products carried by Altınbek and other drivers are immediately brought to the bazaar. At one time, this area was a large cotton field. Cotton was the region's major product. But after the importation of Chinese products began, the cotton field transformed into Kyrgyzstan's largest bazaar in the blink of an eye. There are 20,000 stores flooded with Chinese products. A truck has delivered this. It was packed with Chinese-made children's clothing. Many store owners are former workers, some of whom had been laid off by the closing down of factories. Since the importation of Chinese products began, many people became store owners in order to earn quick cash. The retailers from various Central Asian countries come to purchase goods at this bazaar. Chinese products have created jobs in many Central Asian countries where people are struggling with a sluggish economy. With the creation of the new market, Osh is regaining economic vigor, and its villagers have even begun to recover from its tragic past. This man, wearing the elongated traditional hat, is a Kyrgyz nomad. And this is an Uzbek. They are traditionally agricultural people. In Osh, these two ethnic groups each make up approximately 50% of the population. The origin of the surrounding conflict came from the border line that has now become a national border. After the establishment of the Soviet Union in 1924, the state borders were delineated based upon the ethnic groups. At that time, Osh became a part of Kyrgyzstan. As a result, many Uzbeks, disgruntled by this division, began seeking independence from Kyrgyzstan, and this resulted in a heightened sense of antagonism. And just before the collapse of the Soviet Union, the incident took place. What triggered this event was a fight over the land where Kyrgyz wished to reside and the Uzbeks wished to use for agriculture. During this event, high tensions of nationalism were rising, and the two races collided. The Kyrgyz and Uzbeks each organized vigilante groups. With handmade weapons, the fighting continued for a week. ...600 were dead or missing, and over 4,000 were injured. The Soviet security guards finally put down the conflict.
Азыр ошол кездеги тополоңду эстегендечи, өзүңүздү кандай сезесиз?
Топонду эстегенде, конечно, адамдар жинде аны колазы. Мен айтам да, şu тополоңда болганча бу иш катта кайланып кетиши мүмкүн ди да, чоң болуп кетиши мүмкүн ди. Жакшы вовремя остановили, токтолуп калды, жакшы болуп калды. Агар болмаса бу иш катта кайланып кетиши мүмкүн деп айтам.
It has been nearly two decades since the incident, and there have been no cases of a large ethnic conflict reported in Osh. At Osh's bazaar, Balushbek, a Kyrgyz, sells clothes. His business partner is an Uzbek. At the time of the Uzbek-Kyrgyz conflict, Balushbek had been studying economics at a college. After the conflict, relationships with his Uzbek friends nearly ceased. After graduation, he looked for work but Ash's main companies had been shut down. Balushbek decided to start his own business, and in order to raise startup capital, became a taxi driver. However, he could not accumulate funds in the way he had hoped. Khairullo, an Uzbek, had been working for his family's electronics store, but was hoping to start his own business. These two met through a newspaper ad seeking joint investment in a business. After combining their funds, they were able to open this storefront a year later.
Bizde Kırgız Özbek degen bizdin oyubuzga da kelgen emes ol nerse. Biz Kırgız Özbek degende dağını unutup kalganbız. Biz bir tuğanda eleşteyiz. Kılgan işimiz bir. Aliga aytıpbayız bu. Biz erte menen abetki zavtrakka bir tavağa ovqat alıp kelsek ökübüz bölüp jeyibiz. Bir sındırımdan da birge bölüp jeken adamdarbız. Bizdin ortoosunda ondoy degen söz jok.
16 jıldan beri oşo paytta kimindir aypı bolup bolgon da uş. Азыр ундай эмес, азыр бир тууган сиңес жашап ата.
By trading enormous quantities of Chinese products, Kyrgyzstan is steadily gaining economic vigor. Even so, about 40% of the population is still living below the poverty line, surviving on less than a dollar a day. The political situation is still shaky. Along the road connecting oases, we are heading west towards the neighboring country of Uzbekistan, where they are building a nation for Uzbeks as a majority ethnic group. This is the national border of Uzbekistan. During the Soviet era, this was a state border, but today it has become a national border. A checkpoint has been established here. Uzbekistan is also having difficulty promoting new industries to support its economy. Solving the problem of poverty is the country's main concern. Unlike Kyrgyzstan, Uzbekistan did not participate in the open market economy immediately. Rather, it has retained its socialistic structure and is slowly changing. Further west, the train we hope to ride is crowded with many passengers.
Paxtaga ketyapmiz, paxta tergani. O'zbekistonni pulani to'ldirgani.
Opam paxta terayotgan, o'y menga sanchdi. Men keling.
Paxta ketib turganlarda qo'llar ko'tarib olinglar.
Mana men paxtadan yeyapman. Hammamiz paxta. Mana ko'taring qo'lingizni.
The enormous oasis of Fargana Valley has a cotton field extending beyond the horizon. Those who normally work in town offices or schools are requested by the government to harvest cotton during its season. The fertile land of Fargana Valley was developed during the Soviet era as the largest area for growing cotton. Even today, they boast they are the second largest exporter in the world, and the area is a primary source of support for their economy. We decide to visit the cotton fields.
Uh-huh.
Cotton cultivation is still managed by the government, which buys the entire harvest. The wages are paid by weight, so the women try to pick as much cotton as possible. The women are chatting about the popular Japanese TV drama they like to watch.
Kinolardan gapirib, kulishib-kulishib deringlar. Xitoyda o'shinlarni mana o'shinda aytinglar, o'shinda biroz yaxshi kino bo'lgan.
O'shinam o'zimizga o'xshab. Mehnatga
shug'ullanganmiz. Kechqurun charchab borib ko'ryapmiz-da kinolarni.
Currently, cotton is Uzbekistan's greatest export, with yearly foreign currency revenue of over $900 million. During the lunch break, there is a performance of Fargana Valley's old traditional song and dance. During the harvest season, the government dispatches these dance groups to various cotton fields. This is part of the government's efforts to recognize the laborers who work hard harvesting cotton all day long. The government is hoping to increase productivity by rewarding the workers. At the end of the day, cotton is weighed and wages are paid.
Pullarga kiyinamiz. Kiyim-kechak, kiyim-kechak olamiz.
Qo'yamiz.
Endi kamchilik bor, xudo xolasa endi o'g'il uylab turmoqchimiz. Endi vaqt kelsa, shu pullarga mehnat haqimizga shu.
Working from dawn until dusk, a day's pay is about $4. Having very little chance to earn extra cash, the women of Uzbekistan work in the field for a month until the end of the harvest season without a day off. Heading further west along the Oasis Road, we board a bus frequented by the locals.
Hello. Hello. Hello.
Some are heading to the cotton field. And this is a peddler selling Chinese goods. Even newlyweds are making their rounds to pay their respects. A variety of passengers gathers on this bus. Our destination, Bukhara, is an ancient capital where many ethnic groups have come and gone. It is said that a large change is taking place here too. For 900 years, the call to prayer has echoed from Bukhara's minaret. It is well known as a center for Islamic study. Many pilgrims have visited here from all over the world. Bukhara is also the Silk Road's prominent location for trade, and people of different races have moved into this city. During the 18th century, this location was an important trading hub between India to the south and Russia to the north. The photographs at the time depict Russians, Afghanis, Indians, and others. At the market, the man selling these candies is Iranian. The woman selling kimchi is a descendant of those forced to emigrate here during the reign of Stalin.
Мама русская, а отец кореец. А похоже на узбечку, да? Спросите его.
Surrounded by high walls, these alleyways continue like a maze. These alleyways are considered home to many descendants of various ethnic groups. At 1 p.m, the sound of Islamic prayers echoes through the alleyways. During the Soviet era, the Islamic religion was strictly controlled. After a revival, the number of mosques multiplied 20 times in just 16 years. After the fall of the Soviet Union, the Islamic religion, with its long history, has become the people's spiritual support in this area. At the corner on the same alleyway is a Jewish place of worship, the synagogue. Bukhara's Jews are thought to be descendants of the trade merchants who traveled the Silk Road and came here through Iran and Afghanistan during the 13th century. Over the centuries, Jews and Muslims have coexisted in peace.
У мене на дом приходить 40% другої національності. І зараз теж так. Похорон. Не тільки євреї йдуть на похорон, і другі, ісламські, сусіди, вони теж йдуть туди на похорон. Ми розрішаємо. Понимаєте?
At this place of worship, the synagogue displays photographs of Hillary Clinton. And the former U.S. Secretary of State, Madeleine Albright, has also visited the synagogue.
Потому что они приехали в нашу синагогу интересоваться, как бухарские евреи живут. Живем мирно с исламскими верующими людьми, узбеками, там, ислам верующих. И действительно, Мадлен Олбрат удивился и на свой конгресс выступления даже сказал, я по телевизору слышал, что учитесь с исламом жить вместе мирно из Бухары.
Bukhara's Jews are diminishing in numbers. During the Soviet era, what was once a population of 20,000 has now dwindled to 150. Perestroika made it possible for Jews to emigrate overseas. Many, in hopes of a better life, left for Israel and the United States. This movement was encouraged by Israel's support. One after another, people left for Israel. Jews who have been dispersed all over the world have been called back to Israel, and they have been provided various supports, such as travel expenses. Up to this point, over 1 million people have emigrated back from the former Soviet Union. Zoya is a 45-year-old Jewish woman. Born in what was once a part of the Soviet Union, Azerbaijan, at age 25, she married a shoemaker in this town. Since then, she has been coexisting with Uzbek's Islamic community. However, now she is thinking of leaving this land. Zoya stayed because of her husband's strong attachment to the town. Last year, her husband passed away from an illness, and she has put her home up for sale. Zoya has been contemplating the move because she's worried about her son's futures. Next year, her youngest son, Yosef, will graduate from the Jewish school, but there are no job prospects for him. Her elder son, Jacob, has been searching for work since graduating from school a year ago, but has been unable to find a job. Previously, connections among the Jewish community led to job placement. However, there are no longer people to rely on.
Здесь кругом все евреи были, это все покупали из Бельгии. Это махалля
специально для евреев отведена, как еврейский квартал.
Вообще здесь есть кругом остался один ми, два.
Until recently, this city had provided a livelihood for Jewish shoemakers and tailors. But these occupations have been suppressed by the affordable Chinese products and can no longer provide a living. Jacob hopes to move to Israel. Zoya herself has been unable to find a job. Their living expenses are coming from her savings. Zoya's concern is Israel's mandatory enlistment.
Israel is tough. It won't go. Then the girl is going to army. Вы же знаете.
Армия так строгая там.
Тем более мальчики.
Молодежь, девочки, мальчики сами хотят. Нормальная армия. Дембеля нету там, дедовщины нету. Нормально все. Пятницу отпускают домой, субботу.
Она опасна же. Кому это нужно? Как здесь будет, как в Советском Союзе, это будет Ташкент, здесь хорошо. А там это без конца война, война. Не дай бог, кто знает, что там. Израиль, не хотим.
Slowly, Zoya is getting rid of her personal belongings. Today, she burned her husband's wooden shoe molds to prepare dinner. Once a shoemaker, her deceased husband had gotten these molds, which have been passed on from generation to generation. Zoya is thinking of both of her sons' futures and will decide where to go. Once her home is sold, they will leave Bukhara. On this day, once again, another group of Jewish families is leaving Bukhara. Sosun is moving to Israel. They are moving to find employment for their son, Alisher. Following the Silk Road and migrating to this land, these Jews, who have lived alongside the local population, are now quietly disappearing. Back in town, an Uzbek wedding is taking place. Since its independence, the traditional Islamic wedding has been revived. For millennia, countless ethnic groups have traveled this Silk Road, connecting oasis to oasis. It has been nearly two decades since the fall of the Soviet Union and the rise of the new nations. Now, once again, these ethnic groups are caught up in the tide of a drastically changing world.